Just one more thing before the convergence test that I almost forgot. The rules for limits of series are very similar to those of rules of more general sequences. And so I will just write them down explicitly to have them on the blackboard. This is basically just a special case of a theorem from section 2.1. Namely, if we have two convergence series, so sum over a n and sum over b n, the convergence series n k equal to r or k equal to c, and we give the limits names. So we say that a is the limit of the series over a n, and b is the limit of the series of Bn. Okay, then first part, the sum. We have the sum rule for limits, and for series this looks interesting. Namely, then the sum of an plus bn. Okay, so this we just add the same the pairs with the same index here. This then converges, so this is convergent with limit of the sum of a n plus b n is simply the sum of the limits, which, of course, in series this reads like this. Okay, but please, please, please be careful with the sum. To split the sum into these things, this is only allowed if the a n and the b n are known to be convergent. If we have divergent things in here and there, or some, or we don't know things yet, this sum might be something completely different. There are interesting examples. I won't go into details on this because it will be quite messy in this lecture, so this, we leave this for the mathematicians. But this is important. This only holds if we already know convergence. In general, you cannot just decompose a series into parts. Okay, second thing, for each element of k, so some fixed c in k, we can just take the product of the series with this element, then the sum of c times a n, so taking the series of this multiplied version, this is then indeed convergence with c times limit c times a, which is of course the same as c times sum from n equal to 1 to infinity a n. Of course, this is convergent. I don't have written this down yet, but this is then this convergence rule follows. And this I don't prove because this basically follows from applying the theorems we have for sequences to the partial sums here. So this is just simple computation. Okay, now we come to the convergence tests. And the first one is for a type of sequence which I will give a special name. And let me introduce this name first because this might occur multiple times. Oh, sorry, not 270, 271. So, a real series is called alternating if it is of one of two forms. If it is of the form sum from 1 to infinity minus 1 to the n times a n, or same thing shifted by minus 1, namely the sum minus 1 to the n plus 1 a n, where a n is a non-negative number for all n and n. So this just means we have sums where the sign changes with each sum. And so it's plus and minus, plus and minus, plus and minus, or minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus. So these two forms. So this, we just have this changing of the sign. And in this case, there is a very simple convergence criterion. The proof is not too simple, but the theorem itself has a nice simple criterion. Namely, this is the theorem which is called the Leibniz convergence test. Assume we have an alternating series. Okay, if we know that the sequence an, just without the signs, this is a sequence of non-negative numbers, if this is monotonically decreasing, which is something which is not too hard to check, as we've seen, monotonically decreasing, and if it converges to zero, this is also something that's often not that hard to see in practical examples, as we shall see in a moment, then it already follows that the series converges. Okay, how to see this? Okay, we again let Sn denote the nth partial sum. So this means we've got the sum from k equal to 1 to n minus 1 to the power of k plus 1 a k. So this be the nth partial sum. So now we consider two different cases. We consider two subsequences. Namely, we take the even values as 2k and the odd values as 2k plus 1, where k and n. This is simply because the sign behavior is a bit different. So if we take a look at these sequences, then we can see that these have surprisingly nice properties. Then for all k and n, we obtain that s2k plus 2, which would be the k plus first term of this sequence here. This is, by definition, the same as s2k, and then plus a2k plus 1 minus a2k plus 2. You see that the sign here is negative precisely if k is an even number. So we get this sum here. But since the sequence is monotonically decreasing, we know that this one is smaller than or equal to this one, which means that this thing here in the parentheses is non-negative, which means this is smaller than or equal to 2k. Okay? And the same thing we can, or a similar argument we can apply to the other sequence. We take s2k plus 3, which is the k plus first element of this subsequence. This is s2k plus 1, and then plus, and now minus a2k plus 2, since this is an even index, plus a2k plus 3. Here we know, again, this thing is monotonically decreasing. So it turns out that the a2k plus 2 is bigger than or equal to 2k plus 3. So because of the sign here, this means that this thing in the parentheses is always smaller than or equal to 0, which means that this is smaller than or equal to s2k plus 1. So if we take a look at what this means, this shows that this here means that s2k is monotonically increasing. And the same thing for the odd ones. This implies that s2k plus 1, where k and n, is monotonically decreasing. Okay. So we want to see if they really converge, these subsequences. So we want to apply this theorem again, that monotonicity plus bounds give convergence. And for this, we need one more computational trick. Let me just quickly erase. OK, so we have the monotonicity. To get the boundedness assumptions, we need to make one little computation, which is not that hard anymore. So moreover, at this point, if we just take a look at the difference of an even and an odd one, so s2k plus 1 minus s2k, this is by definition simply a2k plus 1, and by assumption, this is a non-negative sequence. So this means that s2k is smaller than or equal to s2k plus 1 for all k and n. Okay, and this helps us now in getting the upper bounds together with monotonicity, upper and lower bounds. Namely, we get that s2k, we need an upper bound for the sequence s2k. So this is smaller than or equal to S2k plus 1, but since we know that this sequence is monotonically decreasing, this is smaller than or equal to the first one from the sequence, which is S3. Right? So this is an upper bound, since this does not depend on k anymore. So this gives really an upper bound for this sequence S2k, which then gives a convergence. For the odd ones, similar argument, S2k plus 1 is bigger than or equal to S2k. And we've seen that this sequence is monotonically increasing, so this is bigger than or equal to the first one, which is S2. And these two things hold for all k and m. Okay, with that being said, this means that so S2k, k and n is bounded from above. S2k plus 1 is bounded from below. And now we've got monotonicity and the boundedness conditions that we need. And so by theorem, forgotten the number, 235, both subsequences converge. Okay, now we know that the subsequences of the partial sums converge, but we don't know if the partial sum sequence itself converges. So since these two kind of span all the partial sums, I mean, we've got the odd ones and the even ones, and together we have everything. So to get that this works out, we first want to show that they have the same limit, because otherwise it can't work. So we get that the limit k to infinity S2k plus 1 minus the limit, and this is now basically the same trick we used in the proof of the previous theorem, minus S limit of S2k. This is by our limit rule, since now we know convergence. This is limit of k to infinity S2k plus 1 minus S2k. Okay, this is the limit k to infinity of A2k plus 1, and by assumption, this sequence goes to 0, which means that if we call this limit L, it's the same limit for both subsequences, k to infinity S2k, which is the same limit as the limit of k to infinity S2k plus 1. So the even and the odd partial sums both converge against L. And now this looks a lot like the whole thing converges against L, because we've already got everything there. But technically, we still have to prove that the convergence condition for all of for the whole Sn is fulfilled. And for this, we need one additional argument, which is very simple. Namely, it's about convergence. So we take an epsilon bigger than 0. Then, since these subsequences converge, we know that there exists k1 and k2 in n, such that S2k minus L in the absolute value is smaller than epsilon for all k bigger than or equal to k1, and such that S2k plus 1 minus L is smaller than epsilon for all k bigger than or equal to k2. So now we have to see that kind of, if the index is big enough, then everything is in there. And so we just need to see what's the biggest index that we need. Here, everything from 2k1 goes on. Here, everything from 2k plus 1 is fine. So what we do now is to take n0 as the maximum of these two. So 2k1 and 2k plus 1, 2k2 plus 1. Then, since every element of the sequence is either of this type or of that type, and since this is now chosen such that both things are, so both cases are covered here, this implies that Sn minus L in the absolute value is smaller than epsilon for all n bigger than or equal to n0. And epsilon was an arbitrary number, so this shows that the sequence of partial sums converges, which means the series converges. And this is what we wanted to show. So this is our first explicit convergence test. Okay, just a very simple example of a series that can be shown to be convergent in this way. Example 273 by Leibniz test. The so-called alternating harmonic series. Alternating harmonic series, by which I mean this series, sum n equal to 1 to infinity minus 1 to the power of n divided by n. This is an alternating series where this an is simply 1 over n. So there's, this really converges by Leibniz test. Okay, so we can tell that this interesting sequence, so this would be, just to write this down explicitly, we would start with minus 1 plus 1 half minus 1 third plus 1 quarter and so on. So we know that this converges, but it turns out we cannot compute its limit yet. And the limit of the sequence is actually very hard to compute. We cannot yet, we'll see some more tools later, compute its limit, which shows that, so this is a typical example. We have a convergence test which gives us within, so if we know this convergence test, we can definitely say directly it converges, but its limit, yeah, so it's really hard to see. Later it turns out that this limit can be computed, and I'll just give you a preview, since this is using some notion that we haven't studied yet. This alternating harmonic series converges against the natural logarithm of 2. Of course, yeah. Now, this is something that we will see later, which is actually not that simple. We haven't talked about logarithms yet. But this is, some limit that's hard to determine. Okay, in the following, basically the rest of this section. So throughout the following, we decide to work in the real numbers or the complex numbers. Of course, we can always decide for the complex numbers since the real numbers are included. We choose one of the others. All sequences should be sequences in this case. So I won't have to repeat this again and again. Okay, so one more convergence test. So, a series in K, sum from n equal to 1 to infinity of an, is convergent if and only if a certain condition holds. Oh, sorry, I forgot the name. This is Cauchy's convergence test. And here we have an if and only if condition, so which is of course nice since this really if and only if is always good to have something like this. Namely, for all epsilon bigger than 0, there exists an n0 in n such that the following holds: the absolute value of the sum from k equal to m plus 1 to n a k is smaller than epsilon for all n bigger than m, and this is bounded from below by n0. So kind of small sums of elements for big enough indices should be very small. The name Cauchy popped up before in terms of a Cauchy sequence, and this is precisely why we are doing this. Namely, this is, if we take a look at this relation here, this means that for all m smaller than n and two natural numbers, we obtain the following, that the difference Sn minus Sm in absolute value, this is precisely the sum from k equal to m plus 1 to n a k absolute value, which is precisely what's in there. So since this here holds, this condition, if we take a close look at this, except for this n bigger than m, which is, doesn't matter in this here because we always set the signs to make this right, this is precisely the condition of being a Cauchy sequence. So this is just a fancy way of rewriting the condition that the sum of partial fractions, the partial sum, sequence of partial sums is a Cauchy sequence. So claim follows. From the definition of a Cauchy sequence, since we've seen, I haven't written down the number of the theorem yet, A sequence is convergent if and only if it's a Cauchy sequence. So this is just a way of rewriting this definition. So this is how we get an explicit criterion here, just by using this Cauchy sequence description. Okay, seems I have to erase again. Oh, it's this room. Ah, okay. Blackboard's clean, camera's already. Okay, so let's continue here. Okay, let's do some more convergence tests. But before doing so, I will introduce another definition, another term. That's also an important notion for series. Namely, a series sum over one of the an is called absolutely convergent, or we say that it converges absolutely, which is of course the same, if the following series converges, and if the word absolute is contained somewhere, it usually refers to absolute values. So here it does as so as well. So if the following series converges, we just take the series of absolute values of the AN. This is some non-negative real number, so this is a real sequence then. Why this can be a complex sequence, but if this real sequence is convergent. Okay, first of all, how is this related to the usual convergence? Because here we didn't assume that the series was convergent. So, a first observation. Every absolutely convergent series is convergent in the sense we had before. So, okay, why is this the case? For this, we can use Cauchy's convergence test that we had before. That was the last thing I did before I was drawn into the wormhole. So we assume that a series is absolutely convergent. So again, we denote this by the sum over an. Let this be absolutely convergent. Okay, so by Cauchy's test, so we know that it was theorem 274. So by this convergence test, we knew that, this series of the absolute values is convergent. And Cauchy's test, that this is equivalent to this Cauchy, this condition with the epsilons, which I will write down in detail for this case now. For all epsilon bigger than zero, there is a number n0 in n such that the sum of the absolute values of the ak, where k goes from m plus 1 to n, this is smaller than epsilon for all n bigger than m, bigger than or equal to n0. And note that in Cauchy's convergence test, there were absolute values around the sum, but of course here, since every term here is non-negative, there's no need to do so. So this is really smaller than epsilon. Okay, now, we simply use the triangle inequality. Namely, since what we need to estimate for to show the convergence of the series itself would be the absolute value of this sum, of these sums of this type. And we know the triangle inequality. It says kind of that the absolute value of the sum of two elements is smaller than or equal to the sum of the absolute values. And using this inductively, you can just show that really this finite sum is smaller than or equal to the finite sum k plus one, from m plus 1 to n over the absolute value of ak. So
Since this holds and this holds,
then we're almost done. Namely, then it also holds that, and this is now just rewriting the stuff we did here. For every epsilon, there is an n0 such that the absolute value of the sum from m plus 1 to n over ak is smaller than epsilon for all n bigger than m bigger than or equal to n0. And remember that the Cauchy's convergence test was an equivalence, so it's convergent if and only if such a condition holds. So we've now shown that such a condition holds. And so by Cauchy's convergence test, theorem 274, it follows that the sum from n equal to 1 to infinity an is convergent. Okay. So much for that. So we know every absolutely convergent series is convergent. You may ask now, what about the other direction? And it turns out the other direction is just wrong. And we've already seen examples for this. So remark 277. The converse implication is false. So from convergence, we cannot derive that something is absolutely convergent. And the example we've already seen was that this alternating harmonic series, the sum of minus 1 to the power of n over n, this we've derived from Leibniz convergence test, that this is convergent. But the series of absolute values, which would look like this. This is, of course, simply given by the harmonic series. And for this one, we've seen that this is divergent. So the series is convergent, but it does not converge absolutely. And there are many examples of this. So you have to be careful. The other implication just simply doesn't work. Okay, with this notion of absolute convergence, this now helps in establishing some other convergence tests. We will see three more in this video. So the first one is theorem 278, the so-called comparison test. The idea is kind of similar to sequences. There we had some criteria like the squeeze theorem where we can use convergence of well-known sequences to establish convergence of other sequences. And here we do a similar thing for series. Namely, if we have two different series and we know that one of them behaves nicely, then we can use this property to derive a nice property of the other one. So let these be series. And before I was drawn into the wormhole, I said that everything is supposed to be in C or in R. You could do both, but let's assume everything is complex here. So let this be series. And I assume that there is an inequality between the sequences here, between the terms here. So the absolute value of an is supposed to be smaller than or equal to the absolute value of bn for almost every n in n. This now looks almost like in the sequence settings, like in the squeeze theorem. So for almost every n in n. So if we have this, maybe let's put this on this other blackboard so we can see it better. If this holds, so if this sequence, the absolute values of an are bounded from above by the absolute values of the bn. Then, if the series over bn converges absolutely, then also the smaller series converges absolutely. So the series which is kind of smaller in these inequalities, so the series over an converges absolutely. And so it also converges in the conventional way, so not absolutely, but just convergence. And second part, if the kind of lower sequence, so the the series over an diverges, then the series containing the absolute values of the bn also diverges. But we cannot
directly derived divergence of the BN itself. Just keep in mind that it might be a bit delicate, so you have to be a bit careful here, and the absolute values are really necessary in these settings. Okay, let me start the proof on this blackboard. Okay, we know that this inequality between the AN and BN holds for almost every N. This means there is an N0 such that for every bigger N, this inequality holds. So, which means we have, proof of part A, sorry. So let N0 be an element of N such that the absolute value of AN is smaller than or equal to the absolute value of BN for all N bigger than or equal to N0. Then, for all n bigger than n0, I need strictly bigger just for technical reasons, namely we can make a nice estimate. So to show absolute convergence of the an, we need to see what happens to the sequence of partial sums of this series. So we need the absolute values of the ak here. Okay, if n is now bigger than n0, we can kind of split this into two parts, namely we just take the first sum of the ak going until n0, plus the rest. And for the rest, we have a nice estimate. Like this. And now using this inequality here, we can just estimate this from above by the corresponding absolute values of the b's. So this is smaller than or equal to the sum k equal to, from n to, 1 to n0 ak plus the sum over k from n plus 1 to n over the sum of the bk. Okay, so we don't know what this sum is, but we know this is because the series of these absolute values has only no negative summons. So we know that this is bounded from above by the sum of all the bk. So this is smaller than or equal to the sum from 1 to n0 of a k absolute value plus the whole thing, n equal to 1 to infinity of the bn, bn absolute value. And we know that this here converges, so this is really indeed a finite value. And this finite value, this is just a finite sum, so this is a finite number. This is by assumption on the absolute convergence of finite numbers, so we really have here a finite bound, and this doesn't depend on n anymore, on this n. Okay, it's maybe not that smart to keep an n here as well, this might be confusing, so let's call this also k. We know that this is finite, so really we have a finite upper bound. So we call this upper bound c, and note that this doesn't depend on our choice of this initial n anymore. So we only need to assume that n is big enough, and so for every big enough n, we see that this is an upper bound, and so now we're almost done, I just need to erase. So, since this series, let's put now k over bk converges absolutely, this constant c is really finite. So c in R is well defined. So we've seen that for all sufficiently big n in natural numbers n, the series of absolute values of the an is bounded from above by c. And since we have finitely many values left, we know in particular that the series is bounded. So, these sums are bounded. So this means this sequence of partial sums is bounded. N in n, so the partial sums of the absolute values of the ak. And we know that each of these sums is non-negative simply because it's an absolute value, so we can use this criterion theorem 266, which says that a series with non-negative terms converges if and only if it's bounded from above. So this implies that then this sequence of the absolute values converges, which means that the series an converges absolutely. Okay, so part B about the divergence. So if the series over the AN diverges, Okay, if it's not convergent, then it also cannot be absolutely convergent, because we've just seen that if it was absolutely convergent, this would imply that the series converges as well. So if it diverges, it cannot be absolutely convergent. So it does not converge absolutely by theorem 276. Okay, but if it does not converge absolutely, then by part A, this series here, series over the Bn, can also not converge, because there we know that, yeah, if it, so if this would converge, so this means the series over the Bn would converge absolutely, and then by A this would imply the An would, the series over An would converge absolutely, so by contraposition this means that this does not converge. And this is what we needed to show. So this proves the comparison test. Okay, let's give a simple example of how to use this comparison test and to show that a nice family of series indeed converges. Example 279. So we consider the following series. So the sum from n equal to n from 1 to infinity over n to the k. And here, this time, k is some natural number with k at least 2. Okay, we know that if k is equal to 1, it diverges. But what happens to the higher ones? Here we can make a nice estimate. Namely, we compute. And now we need, this is now the idea of using this comparison test. I claim that this here indeed converges. I mean, here, since these terms are non-negative, convergence and absolute convergence are the same. So to show this, we need kind of to compare these terms here, this 1 over nk, with some series where we already know it converges. And there is one which kind of fits in the scheme. Namely, 1 over n to the k. For k 2 or bigger. This is of course always lower than bounded from below by 1 over n squared. So it's kind of, if we can show that this converges, then this converges by the comparison test as well. So we only need to estimate this actually. But we can now do this with direct computation. Namely, we can show that this is smaller than 2 over n times n plus 1 for all n in n. So this is easy to see. So for all n, comma, since n squared is the same as 2n squared divided by 2, which is the same as n squared plus n squared divided by 2, which is bigger than or equal to simply taking n squared plus n over 2, which is n times n plus 1 over 2. Okay, very simple. But we've already studied, except for this factor 2, we have already studied this series. This was one of our first examples. So by example 265.2, this series converges. Namely, we can even compute its value. This series, of course, constant factors by this theorem from above can be kind of pulled out by this roots for limits. So this is twice the sum from 1 to infinity of 1 over n times n plus 1. And this we've precisely computed to be 1, so this indeed gives 2. So this here, this series converges absolutely, so by the comparison test, since this is then lower than or equal to this one, part A of the comparison test then gives us, so 278 part A. This implies that this series over 1 over n to the k converges for all k bigger than or equal to 2. This is a nice example of a family of series where it's actually not that hard, once you have the right tools, to show that they converge, but their limits are horribly hard to compute. And now, with the methods we've seen so far, we cannot compute the limits. Let me just give you a preview. Because as you could maybe see that something non-obvious is coming as a result of this, if we just take the sum of 1 over n squared over all n. This is something which looks kind of, that's, yeah, should maybe not too complicated, we don't know, but it looks not that difficult, but it turns out the result of this is pi squared over 6. which is absolutely non-obvious and which is also not that easy to show. So you really need some hard machinery to prove this. And the same for the other series. So I think for the series 1 over n to the 3, there's a simple, there's another expression where you can also, where also pi is occurring, but I forgot the precise value. But there are formulas like this, and they are really not easy to prove. So this is really, a standard example of limits which are kind of easily shown to exist, but hard to compute explicitly. Okay. Now, there's two more convergence tests, and these next two that I want to see, they have, that I want to present, they have a nice thing in common. They basically use the the comparison test indirectly, but they give a really concrete criterion on the sequence which kind of forms the series, and you can say that if the sequence has this property, then it follows that it converges. This is something that we haven't done so far, only with the Leibniz criterion for this alternating series, which is a very special case, but these ones are much more general. So, theorem 280. This one is called the root test, since it involves roots, as we shall see. Okay, we consider a series over an, and we define a certain value, namely we put r to be equal to, we define this as the lim sup n to infinity of the nth roots of the absolute value of the nth coefficient, of the nth number of the sequence. So this is thing. And you might recall we have seen some examples with sequences where the nth root was occurring, and you might have asked, okay, why do we study these weird sequences? Here they really occur. So these are really, this is where they are seen in wildlife. So when you have to prove some convergence things, there these numbers really play a role. And we shall see in the next section that there's another part where they play a role. So we know that this number is the lim sup of something non-negative. So there are several possibilities. It could be zero, it could be some positive number, or it could be plus infinity if the sequence on the right there is unbounded. So there are three cases of this theorem. Two cases of this theorem where you can really, where you can really make some precise statements, namely the following. If r, so this value here, is smaller than 1, strictly smaller than 1, then the series converges absolutely. Second part, if we see that r is bigger than 1, and this includes the case that the limit is plus infinity, I don't write this down explicitly, this lim sup is plus infinity, this is included here, then we know that the sequence diverges. The series diverges. Okay. So let's prove this. And we will do this by comparison with a series which we have already studied, namely. Okay. First of all, we are in part A, so we assume that this lim sup is indeed smaller than 1. But this then means, simply by construction of this as a limit, that almost every term of the sequence is also lower than 1, and that is kind of epsilon close to this r. So this means if we take some value between r and 1, so let's call this one q, which we can kind of interpret, between r and 1. This is the open interval here. So we can interpret this as r plus epsilon for some very small epsilon. So by theorem 261, that's basically this lim sup property that I've, so there was this idea of with the range between lim inf and lim sup for large n. So by this theorem, there is an n0 such that the nth root of the absolute value of an is smaller than or equal to q for all n bigger than or equal to n0. Okay, but now comes the trick, because we can just take this to the power of n, so this is positive, so we don't need to worry, this is also non-negative, so there's no need to worry here about the signs or about the inequality that might flip, so we get that the absolute value of an is smaller than q to the power of n for all n bigger than n0. Haven't we seen this before? Q to the n, this was really the sum over this q to the n, it's a geometric series. And there we've seen a similar thing. There we've seen that this converges if q has absolute value smaller than 1. So of course here it's a real number, so it's just, yeah, this works here. So then we know that this series converges, and it diverges if it's bigger than 1, but this is what we do in the part b. So here we see that this is a number which is smaller than 1, so the series over these guys here converges. And now this already shows that we can now apply the comparison test. So apply the comparison test with bn, simply given by q to the n. Then the comparison test, so theorem 278 part A, implies that the series converges. And yeah, so it converges absolutely. Okay, so this was simply by, basically it's a corollary of the comparison test, simply by just using a particular, our favorite series, the geometric series, to compare. Okay, for part B, let me quickly erase. For part B, we distinguish between two cases. The first one is very simple to see, namely, if this value of r, so to remind you, this is the sum of the nth root of a n to the absolute value. If this is plus infinity, then this particularly means that the sequence of all roots here, so this one here, is unbounded. But then it's clear that if we just take nth powers, because this kind of goes to plus infinity, then this one here, so simply taking absolute values, this is unbounded as well. But if this is unbounded, then we are kind of already done, because this is a very simple argument. If this is unbounded, then it follows that the sequence, so if the absolute values go to infinity, then the sequence itself, we don't know much about this, but it cannot converge. If it would converge, this couldn't be unbounded because every convergence sequence is bounded. So this is divergent. So in particular, it's not going to zero. But as we've seen, this sequence going to zero is a necessary condition for convergence. So this was theorem, I think I wrote it down somewhere, 226. Then it follows that the series diverges. Okay, now the second point is if this number r, so this was r here, if this lies between 1 and plus infinity, so it's finite, then in particular we know that the sequence of nth roots of the absolute values of the an is bounded, because it's always bounded from below, and if this is if it's bounded, then the dim sup is finite, it has to be bounded. This is bounded. But then we've seen that R, if it's a bounded sequence, this dim sup is an accumulation point of the sequence. Accumulation point of the sequence. But if it's an accumulation point, this means we have a subsequence converging to it. But since by assumption r is bigger than 1, this means there exists a subsequence, so nkth root of a and k to the absolute value, very beautiful with the double indices and the roots, but anyway, now indexed over k and n, there's a subsequence such that such that every element of the subsequence is 1 or bigger. Okay, but now this means, because if we now take the nkth power, if this is if some root is bigger than 1, then bigger than or equal to 1, then the powers will have the same property, simply just by this ordering scheme. So this implies that the absolute value of a n k So this is bigger than 1 for all k in n. So this in particular implies that if this is bigger than 1, then the whole sequence itself cannot converge to 0, because otherwise the absolute values will become smaller and smaller, but we know that there were always elements of arbitrary high index such that the absolute value is 1 or bigger. So an, we don't know what it does, but it does not converge to 0. So by the same argument as before, theorem 226, the series is divergent. And this is what we wanted to show. Okay, so this was a nice example. This root test is a nice example, but we've seen in the root test, so if this lim sup over there, if this is smaller than 1, it's, we get convergence, absolute convergence even, and if it's bigger than 1, we get divergence. The question is now what happens if it's equal to 1, and the bad news is we can't make a general statement. So then it's useless. So if r equal to 1 in the above setting, then the root test does not help. So this sequence doesn't tell us much. And there's a very simple example. So let's take some example, namely the harmonic series diverges. The series over of the sum of the 1 over n squared converges, as we've just seen before. But the limits of these root sequences are in both cases 1. In the first case, we have this here. This is the same as 1 over limit n to infinity of the nth root of n. And this is something we have computed before. This is 1. And also the same argument, just using a little product here, gives that this is 1 as well. Just playing around with the powers. So we see in both cases we get that the limit of the sequence is 1, but in one case we get convergence, in the other we get divergence. In other words, if r is equal to 1, the root test is useless. And unfortunately, there are many interesting cases where this really happens, that this becomes 1, but there are examples where it's really useful, and you can really, where it has some powerful results, and also in the next section we will see how to how we can really use this for an interesting class of examples. Okay, the next thing is another convergence test, so the last one for this section. Yeah, and the last one in general, probably. There exist more convergence tests, but these are the most common ones. The other ones you can also read up in textbooks, which are, there exist more convergence tests. This one is called the ratio test. Okay, we take some sequence, again in k equal to r or equal to c, and we assume that none of the terms of the sequence is 0. Okay, now we can use a ratio, namely the following. If the number lim sup of over n to infinity of the following ratio, we take the absolute value of an plus 1 and divide it by the absolute value of an, so two subsequent elements here. If this limit, the limit superior, is smaller than 1, then the series over the an converges absolutely. Okay, and also we get a divergence statement, but here it's a bit more complicated. If this lim sup of this thing is bigger than 1, we do not get divergence. The criterion is a bit stricter. So, namely, this only holds if this ratio, an plus 1 over an to the absolute values, if this is bigger than or equal to 1 for almost every n and n. Note that this is really stricter than having lim sup 1 or bigger. So for almost every n and n, but then the sequence diverges, the series diverges. And again, we will show this by using the comparison test and again comparing it to a geometric series. just in a slightly different way. Okay, let's give this number a name. I call this one here R again. So now it's not the limit of the roots, but of the ratios. And for part A, I again choose some number between R and 1. Okay, so by the Lim-Sup definition, there exists an N0 in N such that this ratio, An plus 1 over An, both to the absolute value, is smaller than or equal to Q for all N bigger than N0. So this means, just rewriting this and multiplying this by the denominator, the absolute value of An plus 1 is smaller than or equal to Q times the absolute value of An for all n bigger than n0. And here you can now use induction. I will not do this because it's very simple. That if n is arbitrarily big and we just iterate this, so and use this inequality again and again and again, we get that Qn is smaller than or equal to Q times, An. Smaller than or equal to Q times the value of An minus 1, then smaller than or equal to Q squared times the value of An minus 2, and so on and so on. In general, we get that this is smaller than or equal to Q to the power of N minus N0 times An0 to the absolute value for all N bounded from bigger than or equal to N0. So, if we just put Bn, now the comparison sequence, to be just this thing here. Q, Q to the n minus n0 times an0. It holds that this series. So we need to compare this, of course, with the absolute values, but these are non-negative numbers, so the dashes here don't matter. Here we see that this is yeah, we can just, here's Q to the power of minus N0, and here we've got this. These two quantities don't have anything to do with N, so we can just treat them as constants. So this is simply Q to the power of minus N0 times the absolute value of A N0, just a number, times N equal to 1 to infinity Q to the power of N. And here we know, since Q is smaller than 1, that this converges. Geometric series. So again, by comparison test, this shows, so comparison test, this shows that the series of the AN converges absolutely. Okay, so part B, it's a bit simpler. So we assume that this ratio between those two is one or bigger for almost every n and n. So this means in particular that an plus 1 is bigger than or equal to an to the absolute values here for almost every n and n. So and this means there is an element n0 from which we get this inequality. So this is monotonicity basically. So this means there exists an n0 in n with the absolute value of an being bigger than the absolute value of n0 for all n bigger than or equal to n0. And we know by assumption that these numbers here are non-zero, so the absolute value is non-zero. And this, of course, means that the sequence an cannot converge to zero. Does not converge to zero, and so we get by this necessary criterion that the series is divergent. So by this theorem, it follows that this series diverges. Okay, this is the ratio test. And of course, compared to this root test, the ratio test looks much nicer because we don't have to care with these nth roots, which are usually quite hard to handle. So this looks much easier. The bad news is this test is not as good as the root test, as I will explain about this after erasing. Okay, some remarks on the ratio test. First of all, in the same case as before, as for the root test, if this lim sup that we're studying, so the ratios instead of the roots, if this is equal to 1, again, there's no statement possible, no general statement about convergence. And we can really use the same examples. I won't redo this. So the same examples as for root test. Show that for r equal to 1, there is no general statement possible about convergence. Statement possible. Okay, secondly, in the situation of the ratio test, if this lim sup is bigger than 1, it does not apply divergence. So the same thing as in the root test does not apply. So r bigger than 1 does not imply convergence. And I won't discuss this neat idea, just want you to keep this in mind. And I've included an example in the lecture notes if you are interested. There's in fact even an example where the series itself is convergent, but the this value of r is plus infinity, so it's even unbounded. So there can be really strange things happening. So just keep this in mind. And the third thing that I just already mentioned before, the root test is better than the ratio test, actually. The root test is stronger than the ratio test. And what does this mean? Namely, one can prove the following. This lim sup of the roots that was studied in the root test. So this lim sup here, you can show that this is really always smaller than or equal to this lim sup of these ratios. So an plus 1 absolute value divided by the absolute value of the an. Okay, this is something I won't prove here. This is actually not too hard, but I just don't want to take the time for this. But this means that the root test is stronger. Namely, it can happen that this guy here is smaller than 1, so we get some convergence, while this ratio here is not smaller than 1, so why this makes something complicated. And exactly, especially this example in the lecture notes is an example of just that, where this goes to infinity and this is smaller than 1. So if the ratio test fails, the root test might still be valid. On the other hand, if you know that the root test already fails, then you don't need to try the ratio test because it can't be better than that. Okay, so this is, this is the relation between two. So the ratio test is easier to handle, but not as useful as the root test, and it really turns out that although this ratio test looks quite nice, for many, many examples, the result of this is 1. So for many examples where it's kind of, non-obvious that they converge or diverge. Okay, so in general, the last thing I want to do in general about series is another construction that is not directly related to this convergence test, but which is something else worth studying. And this is something I don't want to prove, but I just want to show you a nice construction that we will use in the next section, actually. Namely, if we have two series which are both absolutely convergent, then we can use them to produce another absolutely convergent series. Namely, we take the series Cn, where this Cn is defined, the coefficients here are defined as follows. We take the sum going from 0 to n of ak times bn minus k. So we take all products such that the sum of the indices is n of these two terms here. So where this, so if we define a series like this, so this is a finite sum, this is already defined. So where this for all n in n, so in each degree, kind of so in each n, we sum up all the products of the coefficients whose total index is n, so the sum of the indices is n. When we do this, this is absolutely convergent. And it has an interesting relation to the other sequences. Namely, you can compute that the value, the absolute value of the the value of this limit here, so the limit of the Cn, is simply the product of the limits of the two sequences. So it's simply the limit of the An, so the total sum here, times the sum of the Bn. So there's really this product here. So there's really a, you can this kind of view this as the product of the two series A and Bn. And this is also what we call it, definition 285. So referring to this theorem, this series Cn is called the Cauchy product. Again, Cauchy discovered it first. Cauchy product of the two series, of the sum of the An and the sum of the Bn. Okay. The proof of this theorem is actually not that simple, so you really need to, there's a lot of technical details, and I will include the proof in the lecture notes, but I will not discuss it here. So you just need to know this construction, that we can really construct a series where the product of the limits is the limits of a new series. And we can really write this down there in detail. So the proof is not that important for now, it's very technical, and yeah. If you're interested, you can really study this, and it's yeah, quite instructive actually to see how these multiplications work. Okay, so much for series in general. This concludes section 2.4, and in the next section I will focus on a particular kind of series, namely so-called power series. And yeah, given a particular example, this is the exponential series, which will be very important throughout this term. And yeah, we'll start studying it and then come back to it later, but I will give you first properties and we'll see how this interesting series behaves. See you in the next video.